Well, I think the first race of the Brickyard is going to be one of the most important races of my career. Now, don't get me wrong, the Daytona 500 is an awful big race, but this is an inaugural race, and it's a race with a lot of tradition. And to come to this racetrack for the first time with all these people that are going to be here and win this thing would just be really a great thing, not only for my career, but for all the sponsors and everybody involved. And so it's very big.
It'll be one of the biggest sporting events in a long, long time. I mean, to me, it's going to be big as big Super Bowl, World Series, because everybody's talking about it. A lot of people from home want to come and hadn't got tickets and asked me if I got tickets, and it'll be people from all over the world to come here to witness it. And like I said, it'd be real cool if we could do it and win it.
We're hot right now. We've won 5 races this year, and we want to win the inaugural race.
And we've talked about it for a year and a half, and it's sort of, you said all you can say about it, and you've done all you can do. It's sort of like, okay, I've said it all. Let's go race now. Indianapolis Motor Speedway, it's Road to the Brickyard on the eve of the inaugural Brickyard 400, the beginning of a new tradition at the 2.5-mile oval known as the world's greatest race course. Hi everybody, I'm Bob Jenkins along with Benny Parsons, and we are just a few hours away actually from the beginning of this race that will begin at noon Indianapolis time, actually 12:15 Indianapolis time tomorrow afternoon. And Benny, as I sit here on the front stretch overlooking this facility that I have been covering in one way or another since 1973, this is really weird because I've already done this once for 3 weeks during the month of May, but hey, we're in the month of August and we're getting ready for a race.
The strange thing is, Bob, you did it 3 days.
Right.
They just were here 3 days, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, and we're going to be going home and the race is all over with.
It's an amazing thing that's happened here in the last couple of days, isn't it?
It really is. I really can't describe what it's like being here. You know, yesterday, the excitement and the community, the whole city of Indianapolis, everyone around here is so involved in this thing. It's really unbelievable.
Any surprises in the last couple of days? Now, of course, we're sending about 50 guys home that weren't able to make the race, but were there any real surprises in your mind?
Of course there was. All we got to do is look on the pole position.
Yeah, that's for
sure.
I mean,
did you really think that Rick Mast was going to be on the pole on Wednesday morning?
Not really.
No, I mean, he has one pole position in his career, right?
Yeah.
And to think that he was coming to the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, a racetrack that they've all tested time and again. How many times has Rusty Wallace and Jeff Bodine been here and Rick Mast comes and sits on the pole in kind of a dominating fashion?
Yep.
He beat Earnhardt by 0.2 seconds. I was impressed.
But I tell you, there were predictions that he would be on the pole because he had some very consistent test times when he came here with the team in the last couple of months, and so it wasn't all that unexpected. However, it was somewhat of a surprise. Well, let's go back to yesterday and pick up on some of the qualifying runs that we saw. And here is Rick Mast. As you said, Benny, only one previous pole position, that came at Atlanta in November of 1992.
Car goes through the corner, and yesterday we had some trap speeds, and this car through the corner was faster than anyone all day long. Other cars were as fast as Rick Mast down the straightaway, but no one could compete with him through the corners.
His best qualifying position in 1994 so far has been a fourth at Richmond, and he is currently in 21st position in the NASCAR Winston Cup point standings. His best race finish this year, a third at Rockingham in February. Rick Mast in the north end of the racetrack, headed for turn number 4 and about to complete the run.
But doesn't that car look perfect? It is not bobbled. He went exactly where Rick wanted it to go. Unbelievable lap.
And at this point in the qualifying, Rick Mast was just trying to get in to the inaugural Brickyard 400.
That's the number one objective coming to Indy, is get in the darn race. You know, there's too many good cars, too many good teams here to be worried about the race this early in the game, you know. We got this lap in, now we can really concentrate on the race Saturday. It pays $50,000 to win today, it's $500 Saturday. That's what we're really after.
Well, this certainly would have been no surprise if Dale Earnhardt would have wrestled the pole position away from Rick Mast. Dale Earnhardt took the green flag and began the effort.
Down in turn one, he went in this corner as fast as Rick Mast, but he could not maintain that speed through the corner as well as Mast did.
Yeah, he was several miles an hour faster at the end of the straightaway, but on the other hand, he was several miles an hour slower in the turns than Rick Mast, and that is really the difference.
And it's really strange to see these stock cars moving away from that wall down the straightaway, just like the Indy cars do. I guess they found it. The closer they get to that wall, the slower it makes their car go.
But you predicted, I know, before you saw the cars even out there on the racetrack before practice began, that you thought maybe somebody might try it up high and stay out of that low groove.
I thought that someone would, but did not work.
Dale Earnhardt took the checkered flag and recorded a qualifying effort of 171.726 miles an hour, second fastest to Rick Mast, 172.414. Well, here is the birthday boy. Celebrated his 23rd birthday yesterday, and talk about a crowd favorite. This guy was born in California, but because he had racing in his blood so much, he moved to Indiana so that the state would allow him to run the sprints and the midgets around this area, and Jeff Gordon could get some racing experience. And I'm talking about the age of 12 and 13. Well, he won a couple of championships in the United States Auto Club, but then moved to the stock cars, and this guy is a superstar.
Where is Pittsburgh?
It's just west of Indianapolis, not too far from here, so this is a hometown favorite.
Ray Evernham told me today that now that Jeff Gordon is 23, he's an old man, he's down looking for me a new young driver.
I think he'll probably stick with Jeff Gordon for the next few years. 171.125. Satisfied with that on your birthday, Jeff?
Well, you know, third's not bad. I guess I can't have it all on my birthday. I got a lot of great gifts coming into this day, and I thought maybe we could pull this one off. Maybe we're saving a little bit of that luck for Saturday, but I'm real happy with the run. I'm a little disappointed, you know, with myself. I had to get out of the gas over there in turn two. Car just started pushing on me, and I know that that kept us from getting that top spot, but I knew it was still a great lap. Car was wonderful. These guys did a heck of a job preparing that DuPont show Chevrolet for me today, and I'm happy. I mean, I got a smile on my face. I can't complain, that's for sure.
Third best, 171.1. Now, we failed to mention that Rick Mast sat the fast time on Hoosier tires. Everybody thought perhaps that if Hoosier would win the pole, it would be with this driver, because he has won the only race for Hoosier this year at Pocono. This is Jeff Bodine.
And he sat on the pole with the Hoosier tires at Pocono. And in practice, in tire test, Jeff Bodine ran about a quarter of a second faster than anyone else in all the testing here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. So you felt like that he would be the guy, but Rick Mast was the man.
And he has two pole positions so far this year, as you mentioned, at Pocono, but also one at Rockingham. So he certainly was a favorite to win the pole position, but it just didn't turn out that way. He came close, though. Jeff Bodine off of corner number four, taking the checkered flag and getting a 170.982. Jeff Bodine maybe was a little bit nervous before he went out of the track to qualify.
Hopefully the butterflies will go away a little bit. I'm sure they will. I know they will for me because I'm in the race. We're going to win this race. Hoosier tires are going to win. We're in the Hoosier State. We got to. But the Exide Ford is going to be in victory lane Saturday. I predict that. Don't normally do that, guys. You better bet on us, though.
So a very confident Jeff Bodine didn't win the pole, but he says he's going to win the race.
Did you hear that? I never heard such confidence in my life.
This was a bit of a surprise, Benny. Bobby Labonte, yeah.
What about this as a shot? Bobby Labonte out of no place to qualify fifth. A great run for Labonte.
170.794 for Bobby Labonte, fifth quickest on the day. Bobby Labonte was another one just happy to be in the show at this point.
We're awful tickled. The Max House Pontiac run real good today, and we didn't get a whole lot of practice, but the car was real good up here testing, and we really didn't touch it, so we ran about the same as we did then, so it was real good.
Well, here came Bill Elliott onto the racetrack for the Junior Johnson team. Bill has had not a particularly good year, but he certainly is looking much better after a second place finish at Talladega, and Elliott was looking for his second pole position of 1994. He won the pole at Darlington this year. But Bill Elliott had a 170.338 mile an hour lap, and we talked to him after his run.
Well, we are, but, you know, still it's a situation, you know, from the standpoint of give it your best shot, but you never know.
Well, this team has been struggling a little bit. He's run well in just about every race, but doesn't turn in very good finishes. He's already said that he won't be back with Kenny Bernstein, but I know he wants to give Kenny a win before they end their relationship, and this could be the weekend.
What about winning here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway? All the years that Bernstein has been running the IndyCars, you're trying to win a race. How about if Brett Bodine was to get that victory in a stock car?
Well, of course, Kenny had a win in IndyCars just last weekend at the Michigan 500, so maybe he'll make it two in a row with a win in NASCAR Winston Cup competition with Brett Bodine. Bodine's Quaker State Ford clocking in at 52.915, a 170.084 mile an hour lap for Brett Bodine. We ask him, are you satisfied with this one, Brett?
I didn't expect that to be a pole speed, but we're real proud of that because we came from a long ways back. We weren't very fast today at all, and to come up with that kind of speed, we'll take it, get ready for the race.
Ricky Rudd is a car owner this year and recorded a victory earlier this year, so he may be looking toward a good finish here.
And I tell you, Bob, that has been impressive. Ricky Rudd, as an owner, I felt like he's taken 2 years to get to this point. What he's done in 6 months.
Ricky Rudd, 169.933, and Rudd admitted to it. It's to us, it's different here at Indy.
It's a new set of circumstances for us. Most of these racetracks we can come to and we unload on at the racetrack, and you can just about drive them in your sleep. You've been there so much. But Indy, I didn't really feel comfortable with my qualifying laps. I didn't feel like I hit the corners. I felt like I was wide where I needed to be tight, and I was tight where I needed to be wide. And that comes with experience, and we haven't done a whole lot of testing at this racetrack. But race day is a little more forgiving. You don't have to hit the perfect line. It's much more forgiving. It's going to be for a good race. There's going to be a lot of guys running close together. I can see that.
Weather conditions were kind of weird yesterday. It was hot in the morning, then it rained, then it cooled off, and then it got warm again, and the track conditions changed as the afternoon went along.
As the afternoon went on. How about Sterling Marlin? Won the Daytona 500. What about if he could win the Brickyard in the same year?
169.766 for the Daytona 500 winner.
When I see it changes, you know, like the track changes a lot, and the sun comes out, cloud goes in, and it looks like the guys went early, had the best deal, because, come out rainstorm, and it cooled way off, and then the sun come out, about the 10th guy went out, so we're in the field, and I think we get a shot to win. We'll get our best shot.
Sterling Marlin looking for the big double this year, Daytona and Indianapolis. Here's Mark Martin, the Valvoline Ford, a 169.690 qualification run. As a result of his finish in the most recent race, he has moved to third in the point standings. Mark Martin will be starting 10th in tomorrow's inaugural Brickyard 400.
We felt like we knew what we needed to do to run good here, and we brought our stuff, and we're doing it.
So that was it. Rick Mast on the pole position.
But I tell you, in practice today, leading up to the race, Mark Martin was as fast as anyone. He really was looking good.
And you know, I was watching this happy hour, the final hour of practice here this afternoon. First of all, the crowd was just going nuts. There wasn't a single person in this whole 2.5 miles, 300 acres, that was seated. All of them were standing.
All of them were standing, watching those cars come down the straightaway, nose to tail, side by side. It really was incredible. I sat up and watched it myself for an hour.
It was great. Were they trying to find out whether drafting is going to be a major factor in tomorrow's race?
They were trying to find out whatever they could find out. Was drafting going to be important? What did it change by having a car in front of them, by having a car behind them? Could they pass? Could they go two abreast in the corner? I saw some of that, too. So, they can.
But, you know, we're not going to know how things will go in the race until the green flag drops tomorrow on the event, so anything can happen. Well, that was a look at first day qualifying and second day qualifying. We will be back for more of that in just a moment. The Road to the Brickyard is brought to you by AC Delco Automotive Parts. AC Delco, it's like buying time. And by Pennzoil, the motor oil you can rely on for performance, protection, and quality. We're live at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway on Road to the Brickyard, and we'll be right back. We'll be right back. our fourth and final Road to the Brickyard, live from the Indianapolis Motor Speedway on the eve of the inaugural Brickyard 400. I'm Bob Jenkins along with Benny Parsons. Now, I promised you second day qualifiers in this segment, but hey, we got a lot more first day qualifiers we need to take a look at.
And we've got some that's a little squirrely they need to see.
Yeah, you're right. Rusty Wallace was a first day qualifier yesterday. Rusty, of course, trying to win his second NASCAR Winston Cup Championship. And this is the Roger Penske car. Now, when they came here to test, they brought four cars and nine engines. We know how much Roger Penske wants to win here at the Brickyard. Of course, his IndyCar team with Allenzer Jr. won the Indy 500 this year, and wouldn't it be sweet for Roger to win the Brickyard?
How many times has he won the 500?
10 times.
10 times Roger Penske has won the 500. So you know that he wants his name on this trophy for the very first Brickyard 400.
The run, however, by Rusty Wallace was just the least bit disappointing. It was 169.683 miles an hour, and Rusty will line up in 12th position on the outside of row number 6 for tomorrow's race. And once again, Rusty was caught by the changing weather and the changing track conditions.
Well, it just made the front end stick really good on my car, and the rear end was sliding around on it, but that could be an aerodynamic adjustment I needed to make, but we'll just have to see what happens.
Dale Jarrett was next to go out in the Interstate Battery Chevrolet, and Benny was talking about drivers, shall we say, using every inch of the racetrack, and I think it'll become pretty evident when you see this run that this is what we were talking about.
And I thought the car was pushing because as he came off the corner, he went right up against the wall. But in his post-race interview, he said, oh, watches the car got almost spun out. Wow.
Well, Jarrett ended up with a 169.661, and believe it or not, that was his best run of the entire day.
It's the fastest that we've run here testing and while we've been here today. We made a lot of changes before qualifying from practice. Our car was pushing pretty bad, and that's not the fast way around here. We loosened it up quite a bit and got it pretty loose, almost too much to that side.
Well, perhaps if there was a driver that would knock Rick Mast off the pole position, it could be Ernie Irvin, the current NASCAR Winston Cup points leader in the Texaco Haviland Ford. But a 169.453 was all that Ernie Irvin could muster, and that put him 17th on the grid for tomorrow's race. Let's take a look at the top 20 starters. Rick Mast on the pole. Dale Earnhardt will start alongside. Jeff Gordon and Jeff Bodine will start in row number 2.
Row 3, Bobby Labonte, Bill Elliott. Row 4, Brett Bodine and Ricky Rudd.
In the 5th row, it'll be Sterling Marlin and Mark Martin. Morgan Shepherd with a good qualifying effort, and Rusty Wallace will start in row 6th.
On the inside of row 7 is Greg Sachs, U.S. Air Car, and Dale Jarrett. Michael Waltrip in row 8 alongside Dave Marcus. Great run from Marcus.
And in row number 9, Ernie Irvin along with Jeff Brabham. Another one of a bit of a surprise. Jeff Brabham, not a regular NASCAR Winston Cup competitor, but he's driven this racetrack many times. Rich Bickle and Hut Strickland will start 19th and 20th in tomorrow's inaugural Brickyard 400. And we'll have more live on the Road to the Brickyard in a moment. Welcome back live to the Indianapolis Motor Speedway for Road to the Brickyard. Tomorrow's inaugural running of the event at 12:15 Indianapolis time. Seated to my right is John Andretti, who did an outstanding job qualifying for this race here today. Starting 28th tomorrow. Was it a bonsai run today?
Winston Cup, there's no such thing but a bonsai run. And trying to get in the Brickyard 400 is so important. I think it's such a big event for everybody that's involved because everybody wants to be involved. There can only be one inaugural, and if you miss the 500, you can always come back next year and make it, but you can't come back and make the first run in the Brickyard 400.
Boy, a lot of firsts for you this year because you, of course, were the first in history to run the Indianapolis 500 and the World 600, Coca-Cola World 600, in the same day. And now you run two races here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. So you're making records all over the place here.
Well, I don't know. Schrader, he seems to show up everywhere, so I kind of look a little bit tame to Schrader. It's just I do, I guess, as Schrader says, you're doing bigger races than I'm doing. But I really enjoy it, and I just love racing. And when they announced the Brickyard 400, I, I just wanted to be a part of it, and I'm glad that it worked out. The timing actually worked out good, and I didn't intend to go NASCAR because of the Brickyard 400. It just actually worked out that way.
More pressure for qualifying for the Brickyard 400 or the 500?
Definitely for me, more for the 400, because I'm still learning the race cars, and we didn't get the test here, but, you know, a day, and with that, we typically don't get the test, but a lot of other guys tested a lot more often, and it really, everybody came here with their guns loaded, and so when I come here for the Indianapolis 500, you got 2 weeks to get it right, and I always, you know, I know more what I'm doing in an Indy car than I do in a stock car right now, and so I'm, therefore the confidence level's there.
Now, don't sell yourself short here. Did your experience running this racetrack help you today?
Yeah, you know, I know how far the walls are away, because, you know, they come up just as quick at 170 as they do at 220, because, you know, the cars are so much heavier and you're just sliding. And sometimes you're not quite sure they're going to quit sliding. You might actually have to use that to stay inside.
We know this is a big deal to you, the Brickyard 400, but the feeling in the garage here with all the other Winston Cup drivers, is it a big deal for them? They're talking like it is, but is it really a big deal to them?
Just look at the way they talked about coming here and testing, and the way they talked about building special cars. And I'm garage with Dave Marcus, and he's got a brand new car here. And, you know, and Dave's like us, you know, on a limited budget and just trying to do it. And, you know, but that's how important this race is. You came here, and that, I guess, says how important it is to them. And, you know, I'm sure Rick Mask is really enjoying it.
Well, don't you know he is? This is probably more money. Winning the pole here at the 500 is probably more money than he's won in any race.
Yeah.
Yeah, and he also got a van. I saw him drive away.
That's
and
right.
I'm going to cut the tires, you know? But I'll save that for Junior. I was going to cut his tires too in May. But, you know the way it is, Benny. You know, you don't like to see anybody else win it if you can.
Exactly. I understand.
But Rick's a good guy and well-deserving, and he's been in Winston Cup a long time. And boy, what a great way to, or something to add to your resume after being in so long. And, you know, so I'm real happy, real likable person. Of course, most of them are.
We're happy that you made the race, and good luck tomorrow in the Brickyard 400. Thanks very much for stopping by.
Thanks, Bob and Benny. It's good to see you again,
Benny.
Good to
see you, John.
All right, John Andretti, back with more recap of qualification runs today here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway on Road to the Brickyard. Live from the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, this is Road to the Brickyard on the eve of the inaugural running of the Brickyard 400. I'm Bob Jenkins along with Benny Parsons. Well, we've pretty much wrapped up first day qualifying and the establishment of the top 20 in speeds. And so today in the early practice, those guys that were locked in began to work on race setups, and we saw some great action on the racetrack in this morning's practice session.
Wow, look at the field of cars, nose to tail, going through the corners, trying to feel everything out. Sterling Marlin, Morgan Shermer, they went Ricky Rudd and Jeff Bodine. Look at Jeff Gordon. Did he pull away from these guys or start there?
Again, they're just getting the feel of the track, wanting to know whether they can draft, whether or not they're going to be able to run two abreast in the corners. And I think they will.
I think they will before the day's over.
You know, yesterday in the early practice session, three cars were wrecked in the first 20 minutes of practice, and we thought, oh my goodness, this could be a real major problem. Earlier today, Jeff Bodine, there he is, getting up very close to the wall, putting a black mark on the wall, but no real major damage to the car.
That was close to serious damage to an Exide battery car.
But then we did have a rather serious incident involving Ben Hess. This was in corner number two, and Ben got into the wall, and as you can see, he hit the wall on the left side of the machine, damaged it quite heavily, and as a matter of fact, they had to cut Ben Hess out of the car. Benny, here it is again.
There he is, the highlighted car, the white car up next to the wall. He's passing a slower car on the inside. Now, the camera goes with Sachs. I don't know if there was contact between Hess and the slower car, or if Ben just lost it going in the corner. And I will say, they did hold him for observation over at Methodist tonight.
Yeah, apparently he does have a concussion, Benny. He was knocked out, but he had regained consciousness and was awake and alert when they got him to Methodist Hospital. But they decided just to keep him there for observation. So I don't think it's a real serious situation for Ben Hess. We certainly hope not. This is Jerry O'Neill losing control.
Yeah, he got the car out of shape. back and forth. We saw the flaps go up, keep the car on the ground, and around he goes. They had about 2 360s, no damage.
This is Robert Sprague now. This was on his qualifying run, and this came just at the end of our ESPN telecast of qualifications this afternoon. He got the car into turn number one, and then it got out from under him.
He got in the corner a little bit too hard, and you can see heavy contact with the left rear of that car and the left side of the car.
And again, those roof flaps popped up and kept the car on the ground. This is Lance Wade, another NASCAR Winston West competitor, and he also is spinning around, but he kept it off the wall.
Hey, did you see that? That was like Danny Sullivan when he did the 360 and went off to win the 500. Remember that?
Yep. He didn't keep going, but nice job of driving by Lance Wade. Stan Fox, an Indianapolis 500 veteran, who is trying to make the field, but he came out of the fourth corner a little too high and caught the wall.
He did catch the wall. Looks like he was going for a camera.
Here's a second angle. As you can see, he's way up out of the groove as he comes through four.
He's definitely out of the groove and goes up and smacks the wall pretty good with the right side of the car.
So Stan Fox, hope of making a second race at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, comes to a conclusion as the Delta Fawcett's car was not able to make a qualifying run. Here is Dick Trickle, and here was one of those guys who in the late afternoon was just trying everything he could to get into the show.
Wow, just barely touched the wall and did not qualify for the Brickyard 400, was one of the last cars bumped.
168.479, he was 42nd fastest qualifier, but he did not make it. Here's the guy that took the pole position at the Daytona 500, Loy Allen Jr., but he has been plagued with problems since he arrived here at the Speedway, and as he came out of the corner, down the back stretch, the car got out from under him, and he made contact with the inside wall.
And we saw it start way back in the second corner, and he fought it all the way, almost all the way, halfway down the back straightaway before he lost control. See, he gets the thing back straight, back out again, he comes back straight once again, almost straight. Now he turns it again, and this is the final, this is a straw that broke the camel's back. Around he goes. Looks like that spin at Talladega in the ARCA race in May. Remember that spin?
Yep, it sure does. Benny, is there a common thread in these spins? Is there anything that particularly caused all of them, or was it just the driver trying so hard to get into this thing?
The driver trying so hard to get that last ounce of speed. You know, if you drive the car in one car length deeper and you make it and you get on the accelerator one car length deeper, you're going to go faster around this racetrack, and that's what they're all trying to do.
So that was the story. No major injuries at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway in practice or qualifying for the Brickyard 400, but a few incidents of spins and wall contacts. We'll be right back. Well, the sun has moved behind the front stretch grandstands. Darkness is beginning to fall over the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. When the sun rises again, it will be time for the day of the inaugural Brickyard 400. Welcome back to Road to the Brickyard. I'm Bob Jenkins. Benny Parsons is over here, and the man of the last couple of days is right here. This, ladies and gentlemen, is Rick Mast, who will start from the pole tomorrow. Aren't you the man about town?
Pole position.
Huh?
I'm telling you, I didn't know there was this many video cameras in the whole country. I've never seen so many TV cameras in my life. I'm starting to realize what Austin Bill went through in 85, and Harry went through when he won those races, and he's got
to
go through.
But isn't it a good feeling?
Oh, man. It pays good, too. Pays real good.
We've been talking about that. You won, what, maybe $100,000, yeah, which is more than you can win in a lot of races.
Yeah, that's true. That's what we were talking about that last night. That's the first thing we do. Schrader taught me that. Figure out how much you're going to make before you go to the racetrack.
Did you drive that van home? I saw you having your picture
made by
Listen,
Benny, that. Richard got the van.
Did he really?
Karen, his wife, she sat down in the van before I ever even seen the van.
Really?
I said, Richard, this deal's supposed to be 50-50. He said, well, let's just saw the van in two. You know?
That'll solve that problem.
But who gets the steering wheel? That's the biggest.
Richard
got the steering wheel.
Yeah.
Well, let's talk a little bit about yesterday, Rick.
Okay.
Now, when you came here this weekend, really, you had some great practice runs, and here you are qualifying. I asked Benny if this was a surprise. He said, yeah, but for a lot of us, it wasn't, because you were very good in testing.
Well, you know, the problem is, the guys in the garage area, the insiders, it's not a surprise to them, because, you know, the way our car's been so running so good this year, with the exception of Talladega and Daytona. So many races, you know, we had problems. There's 3 or 4 races we felt like we could have won. A lot of races should have been in the top 5. We didn't. The final stats don't show it. You're a little bit removed from the sports. You don't see that. And We came here last week and tested the car in a 5225. We qualified yesterday at a 5220, so we backed up what we did a week ago. The car was just right. Little push off too. Maybe it cost me a tenth, but good enough for the pole, man.
But other cars were a little bit faster than you in practice. Didn't other cars run about 52 flat, 5180, something like that?
Last week in testing,
yes.
You mean?
Yes.
I'm not sure just how kosher they were.
Yeah, how accurate
sure
they were.
How legal they were. We were straight up legal. I'm not saying anybody would stoop to that level in Winston Cup racing.
Never.
Never. But I don't know about that. You know, when you go through that inspection line, ready to qualify, things kind of have a way of equalizing.
Rick, was this place easy to adjust to? I mean, you'd never been here until a few months ago.
Yeah, it was. I tell you, we got here Monday to test a week ago. There's four turns here, right?
Yep.
All four turns, exactly the same to me. When we left here Wednesday, each corner is like a different racetrack. You know, it became that simple to me. In other words, each turn's got its own little tendencies. You got to drive a little different, set up a little different, and, you know, just adapted good to it for one lap.
Explain how you would go in turn one a little bit different than turn three.
Well, one, you can get in a good bit deeper than three. One, you get in deeper, you're going past that one sign down there. When you see the wall, you know you're going to hit the wall, you're going to die. You go like two car lengths further. Get out of it. Cut it easy. Get right to the bottom, hit that baby wide open, go. Going into three, they got markers, 3, 2, 1.
Yeah.
You need to be out of the gas by the one marker. Because if you don't, you will hit the wall, I believe. You know? But what you can do is get out of the gas a little quicker in one or in three, get back in the gas quicker. Makes the best speed. In one, you go in deep, get the gas quick. If you get out of the gas quick, get in quicker, it's slower.
Now, you mentioned you were good.
You understand that?
He probably doesn't.
I know he does.
I didn't understand a word he said.
You mentioned one lap.
Yeah.
How are you going to be able to race? We hear you will or won't be able to run two abreast. There'll be a lot of drafting down the straightaways. Tell me what you think.
Well, Bob, the problem is here, nobody knows this racetrack. Yesterday from 9:30 to 12:30, this track changed more than any track I've ever been on in my life. Then it rained. It changed again for qualifying. Today it changed. The last half the hour of practice, it was completely different than it was this morning. Tomorrow it's not going to be overcast. Or it shouldn't be overcast. The sun's going to be shining. We don't know. We honestly don't know what to expect. Nobody has anything to judge off of.
You going
to
lead the first lap?
I'm worried about the 100. I've said this 1,000 times, guy. The 160th lap.
Right.
If they want to lead it, they can lead it. I don't care if I'm fast enough to lead, I'll lead. If I'm not, I'm not going to take chances. The 160th lap. It's $500,000, Benny. You can relate to that. To win.
That's what Kenny Shredder taught you.
No amount
to win.
Yes, sir. Kenny taught me a lot, and that's one of them.
AJ Foyt's in the show.
Yeah,
how about
AJ.
That?
He was pretty instrumental. We came here Monday on his test. He invited us to come, and we came and tested. Just me and him. He helped me a good bit. Our car was good yesterday, the last practice. Then it rained. I said, what's it going to do? Everybody's thinking, what's the track going to do? Just thinking of other things. I go to AJ, he tells me, here's what the track's going to do, Rick. Huh. Don't listen to them other cats. I said, all right. So we did. We listened to him, adjusted the car according to what AJ thought the rain was going to do, and he was dead right.
Rick, congratulations on the pole position here for the Brickyard 400.
Thanks.
A lot of luck tomorrow.
It's going to be exciting. It's going to be exciting for the fans.
Good luck to you, Rick.
Thanks, Benny.
That's Rick Mast, and we'll be right back with more Road to the Brickyard. And in our next segment, we will talk to Lake Speed, who's in tomorrow's show. Stay with us. Here on ESPN, welcome back to Road to the Brickyard, live from the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. In about 20 minutes' time, live coverage of the Kroger 200 Busch Grand National race out at Indianapolis Raceway Park, about 7 miles from here. And joining Benny Parsons and me in this segment is Lake Speed, the driver of the Quality Care Ford. Lake, what a sweat-filled afternoon.
Well, it's been a tough weekend, I think, for a lot of people here. There's no question about it. And I think we're right now to the point that every driver that came to Indianapolis 2 days ago wanted to get to. Let's get this qualifying thing over with and get ready to race. And I know for myself and the Ford Quality Care team and everybody else, that's what we do best, and that's what they pay the money for, is how you finish tomorrow.
Is the race itself. Was there any surprises in qualifying? Did you see any surprises in qualifying?
Not a lot of surprises. I'm going to say some people might have run just a little bit better than folks had thought they were. Maybe a lot of people, some people might have been surprised at Rick, but we happened to be up here testing the same time he was, and he never did run anything but fast the whole time. I mean, wore out tires or whatever, he was always fast. So there was no real surprise there. I was just, the only thing I was worried about was if he was running that fast, was a bunch of them going to run a whole lot faster than that? And that really had us worried.
But no one did run any faster.
So that kind of made things, brought it back to life.
Blake will start from a provisional spot tomorrow. Was there a lot of emotion for you here in these last few minutes of qualifying?
Not really, because the Ford Quality Care team's been real steady all year long, luckily. And we were in a points position so that we knew we had a provisional and we were locked in to make the race no matter what happened, really. But we were, nobody wants to take a provisional. Everybody wants to run good, and be well up in the field. But we had a mechanical problem with the car that we really weren't aware of at the time, and we found it out later, and made a lot of sense why we had the problems we did.
So after you found the mechanical problem and repaired it, you were able to run faster?
Well, it hadn't been repaired yet, because we just found it out at the end of the practice session, so they'll have to finish the repairs and change the rear housing and everything in the car tomorrow.
So it'll be a bit of a surprise to you when you take the green flag tomorrow to see how things
are. Yeah, we'll kind of roll the dice a little bit, but we're going to have to just use past judgment experience to come up with the right setup for the car tomorrow.
Well, it's not where you start, it's where you finish, by golly, and you're at the back of the pack, but hey.
And they pay $25,000 for whoever moves up the most.
That's right.
$25,000.
Yeah.
He's like Kenny Schroeder and Rick Ness.
Right. Everybody's got money on their mind.
you try a bad situation, you got to make something good come from it, right?
That's right.
That's right. Thanks for stopping by. Best of luck tomorrow in the Brickyard 400.
Thank you.
Good to see you. That's Lake Speed, and we will be back with more, wrapping up what's happened here in the past couple of days on Road to the Brickyard. Welcome back to Road to the Brickyard, live from the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. I'm Bob Jenkins along with Benny Parsons, and about a half hour ago, we promised you second day qualifying. We've had so many guests drop in that we haven't gotten there yet, but let's take a look right now at what happened today when qualifying got underway for second round. The man of the day was Terry Labonte in the Kellogg Chevrolet.
He had a great qualifying run. I don't really know where his speed would have put him.
I think he's ninth or tenth fastest, Benny. It was a really good performance. Let me look it up here. He is the eighth fastest, as a matter of fact, 170.046.
And he felt like yesterday that something was wrong. He got the car loose, pushing, or something happened that he did not qualify, because Labonte is always a great qualifier.
Yeah, he was 26th fastest after first round yesterday. He clocked a 168.574 yesterday, but today he moved it up to 170.046. He'll start 21st on the grid. He is the fastest second day qualifier, and as I said, that makes him the eighth fastest overall. So a good run for Terry Labonte, who himself has recorded a victory in NASCAR Winston Cup competition already this year. And for Terry, as it is with most of the drivers who have qualified for the Brickyard 400, this is a big deal.
That's the biggest race of the week, is making the race. I was kidding somewhere in the garage. I said, I think I can win the race if we can just make it. But it's a tough deal. There's a lot of cars here.
Wally Dahlenbach has had problems along the way this year, but the team seems to be turning around. He didn't get a chance to qualify yesterday, but today he did well.
Had a great run in Talladega just a couple of weeks ago. Felt like he was gaining some momentum. Went out to qualify yesterday. Broke an engine on a warm-up lap. Had to come back today.
His speed, 169.96.
We're happy with that. We worked on a car hard. We think we could have done that yesterday, and we wish we would have had it. It would have been accounted yesterday, and I think we would have been a top 10, but we got a good race car, and we get back and work on it so we can run that last practice and get ready for tomorrow.
Well, there are three Bodine brothers in the race tomorrow. Jeff, Brett, and Todd Bodine, the driver of this car. Todd qualified at 169.396 miles an hour. And Todd Bodine compared this racetrack to the one at Pocono, Pennsylvania.
It's really a lot different. Pocono's as rough as a corn cob, and this place is as smooth as glass. So, it's a little bit the same, that the sweeping long corner like at Pocono and a little flat, but really it's a lot harder for me. We didn't get up here to test, and every time I go out, I get a little better. So, I'm really looking forward to running 400 laps here, 400 miles rather, and getting some more experience. I think by the end of the race, if we've got a good car under me, I think we can be up front.
There weren't very many Indianapolis 500 veterans who came here to try to make this race, but here was one of them who surprisingly, well, maybe surprisingly, got into the field in 26th starting position. This is Danny Sullivan in the corporate car of Indianapolis, 169.2.
And Bob, really and truly, I felt like that Danny Sullivan could have been anywhere from 5th to 40th in his qualifying.
Turned in a good performance. We talked with Danny Sullivan about his thoughts after his qualifying run.
I didn't think I made it because I slid it real bad in two. I actually had to put opposite lock in it, sliding it off there, and I thought, well, everybody told me if you do that, you lose a mile an hour or two, so I thought, well, that's it, you know, and the field was so bunched up there in the 68s, you know, that I thought, I've only run a couple laps over 68.4, so I ran a 69.3 this morning, and I thought, when everybody started applauding coming down the back, I thought, well, maybe it wasn't a bad lap, you know, so I'm real happy. I'm tickled pink. I mean, that was just great.
No one has talked more about how great it is to run at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway than Darrell Walker.
He is really tickled to be here and wants to win this race probably as much as any race he's ever run.
Darrell Waltrip starts 27th, qualifying at 169.186.
Yeah, a little better than yesterday. Just didn't get a good run in yesterday. The car didn't run very well yesterday. We put another engine in it for today's qualifying run, and it's much better. And I really feel good about the race. We practiced well this morning, and the car was real comfortable for me and ran good on used tires. That's something we always look for. So looks like the Western Auto car is going to be right there when it all gets going.
Have you ever? And there was a huge...
I mean, I thought maybe, I said, man, I must have broke a track record because everybody's waving, they're screaming, they're hollering, they're waving their hats. I said, man, I've done something pretty spectacular here. But it's just a great feeling.
That's what I was going to say. The crowd went wild when he made the race. Here's a guy that we had on live earlier in our program, John Andretti from Indianapolis, Indiana, qualifying at 169.182. He'll start 28th in tomorrow's race.
I think it might be a little bit better. You know, certainly if the sun comes out, this track heats up a lot. At least with the Indy cars, it makes a big effect. I don't have enough experience in a stock car to tell you what it's doing because things always sliding for me. I don't think if it was 105, I could tell the difference.
There were a lot of skeptics here this weekend thinking that A.J. Foyt may not be able to make the race. It's been a while since he competed in stock car competition, but he wanted to come back to the Indianapolis Motor Speedway where he made his mark in all of racing and get into this field, and by golly, he did it. He starts 40th. He was the slowest qualifier, but hey, he's in the show.
I tell you what, Bob, you know, how long has it been since A.J. Foyt was on the bubble at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway? And he was there for about six or seven cars to shoot at him and try to knock him off. None of them could, but I know he had to be sweating just like the rawest rookie at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway.
I'm sure he has placed many drivers in that position before in the Indianapolis 500, but Foyt himself was on the bubble. And you notice that the car is not getting through the third and fourth corners real well, but again, it was good enough to get into the race. His average was 168.596 miles an hour. A.J. Foyt qualifies for the Brickyard 400. He's in the show.
Well, if we get in, it's going to mean a hell of a lot. It really is. I'd be very happy.
Super Tex in the show, and you know that he's going to be going toward the front when the green drops.
If he has a car that's capable, he will definitely be going towards the front.
That's how it wound up as far as qualifying is concerned here for the Brickyard 400. And as the shadows grow longer and night falls over the speedway, we're on the eve of the Brickyard 400. Welcome back live to the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, our fourth and final Road to the Brickyard. Bob Jenkins along with Benny Parsons. We've got Busch Grand National Racing from Indianapolis Raceway Park coming up in about 5 minutes. But Benny, let's take a look now at how they will line up for tomorrow's inaugural Brickyard 400. As you know, Rick Mast and Dale Earnhardt are on the front row. The second row consists of Jeff Gordon and Jeff Bodine. Starting in row number three, Bobby Labonte and Bill Elliott. Row number four, Brett Bodine and Ricky Rudd.
Back in row five, we find Sterling Marlin, Mark Martin, Morgan Shepherd, and Rusty Wallace in row six. Row 7, Greg Saxon, Dale Jarrett, Michael Waltrip, and Dave Marcus in row 8.
Ninth row, Ernie Irvin and Jeff Brabham, Rich Bickle, and Hut Strickland go from row number 10.
Terry Labonte, Wally Dallin back in row 11, Kenny Schrader, Jimmy Hensley, that's the qualifiers today.
Todd Bodine and Danny Sullivan lined up in the 13th row. The 14th row consists of Darrell Waltrip and John Andretti.
In row 15, we find Jeff Purvis, Joe Nemechek. Row 16, Jeremy Mayfield and Bobby Hamilton.
In row number 17, Ward Burton and Jimmy Spencer. Row number 18, Bobby Hillen and Kyle Petty.
Row 19, Jeff Burton, Ted Musgrave. Derek Cope was 39th and A.J. Foyt qualified 40th.
Now there are two NASCAR Winston Cup provisionals. Those are Lake Speed and Harry Gant. And the 43rd and final starting position goes to Mike Chase as a result of his leading the NASCAR Winston West point standings. Three provisionals. There's no need for a former champions provisional because all the former champions did make it in on their speed. Well, we will be back to continue our Road to the Brickyard from the Indianapolis Motor Speedway right after these messages.
The electronic control module for ABS waits all its working life for moments like this. Anti-lock brake control, another little black box from Delco Electronics.
America is still the land of rugged individualists.
I was strong as I could be. Nothing ever got to me.
And every one of them demands something different from their Chevy truck. But they all want the same thing.
Like
the most dependable, longest-lasting trucks on the road.
Da-da-da, da-da-da.
ESPN's Road to the Brickyard has been brought to you by Chevrolet. One car company has won more races in the history of NASCAR. Genuine Chevrolet. And by Delco Electronics, the official sponsor of the Brickyard 400. Well, I would like to remind you that at noon tomorrow Eastern Time, we will have another preview show of the Brickyard 400 here on ESPN. Then, of course, the race on ABC. And coming up, Benny, from Indianapolis Raceway Park, the Croker 200 Busch Grand National Race. Jerry Punch and John Kernan and
Ned Jarrett
and the whole crew. So
and David Green on the pole.